Hey, it's John at Tinderbox Arts. Today I'm going to do a demonstration of recutting bearing edges on a couple of drums that I own. So these are Tama Imperialstar concert toms from the 1980s. I've owned this since new. Now what's unique about these drums is that when the rims are installed, the bearing edge is actually exposed. So if you hit a rim shot, you're actually hitting the bearing edge, which obviously is not a good thing. And going back decades, I had a girlfriend once that tried to play some drums and screwed up the edges here. And just over the years, they've taken a beating. So I don't use these on my main kit anymore, but I figured I'd fix them up for the heck of it. So some of the challenges that I face beyond that are that the bearing edge on this particular brand and model is different from a lot of other drums. The outside edge here has a rounded profile. The inside edge is a bevel, but it's not a 45, it's something more severe. So duplicating this profile is going to be a little bit tricky. Some other things I have to worry about are that I don't want to try to replace the wrap on this drum because I would never be able to duplicate it. So if I try to work around using the existing wrap that's on here, there's a seam right here, and that's going to get in the way of me cutting this edge up here. The profile up here, you know, this seam is going to telegraph into that when I try to cut it. So I know in advance, this section right here, I'm going to have to do some hand work in order to smooth this and make it good again. Otherwise, I'd have to take this wrap off and that would be a problem. Some of the other issues with this drum is that it's not perfectly round. I mean, it looks pretty round, but if you actually measure it, it's not. So, you know, that limits how I can set up jigs in order to cut these bearing edges. We'll talk about that some more. And one more issue I have is that the inside of this drum is coated with this material here. They used to call it Zola coat, I think. Really, I think it's just a series of three different color paint, but whatever it is, it's in the way here. So when I cut through, I'm gonna be cutting through that. All right, here's a close-up of the bearing edge. And you can see on the outside here, it's rounded and the inside here, we've got that bevel that we talked about. So on the outside, I'm going to be using a router bit, and you see we have a ball bearing here on the bottom of the bit, and that will ride against the outside edge. And that's why that seam that we talked about earlier is going to be a problem. When this gets to that seam, it's going to bump out, and that's going to telegraph through up here. So I already know that. It's fine. I can touch that up by hand. But the other issue is that the standard round over bits that I have are not exactly the same profile as this. So I've made the decision that I don't really care too much. It is possible I could tilt it a little bit one way or the other, which involves setting up some jigs or a special type of router table, and that might make it slightly better, but the difference is not that great. So here's a close-up of the inside edge, right? And you can see it's got this bevel here, but if I hold a 45 degree bit right there, you can see it's a much more severe angle. I didn't measure it, but it's, you know, it's obviously more severe than a 45. So if I try to use a 45 bit straight up like this, it's going to cut the top part here but not the bottom, and you know, it's a different profile, it's going to look different than the other drums. So what I would like to do is get something closer. I may not get exact, but closer to what's there. One way I could do that would be to tilt this bit. So now my 45 is at some different angle, I don't even know what. I can still potentially use the ball bearing and ride that against the inside edge of the drum if I'm careful, but I have to tilt the bit. And in order to do that, you gotta tilt the router. Now I do own two different router tables. I have this one, I have another one over here. So, you know, I have possibilities, but to tilt the router requires a special jig for a router table. It's just more than it's worth for me right now to do. But I have a different solution. So what I've done here is just take a piece of plywood. It's pretty thin. This is only 1/4 inch. Arguably, I should be using 3/8 or 1/2 inch, but this is what I happen to have as scrap. And I took a very small router. This is what I call a pony router. Actually, it's a Bosch router called a Colt. It's a good router, actually. And what I did was installed this piece of plywood as the bottom plate. Ordinarily, you have this plate right here, which is goes on the bottom of the router. So I took that off and installed this piece of plywood instead. And on one side, I used a series of washers to space out this from the bottom, the base of the router. So as a result, this board is tilted relative to the router. And on the business side here, the router bit sticking out, this is a 45 degree router bit, but because I have the base itself tilted, this angle is greater than 45, I'm not even sure what. And I've kind of matched up as best I could by eye to the drum. So now I have this board at basically the right angle and the bit in basically the right place. Now there's more than one way I could use this jig. One of which is if I have a larger drum like this, I could use this base, you know, piece of plywood base plate that I created to span the entire drum, keep the drum like this stationary, and then I would move the router around the drum in order to cut that inside bearing edge. If I'm going to do it this way, I would take this quarter inch plywood and I would strengthen it a little bit because I don't want any flex at this thing, and this has some flex. So you could take a piece of wood and put it across here just to strengthen it, or you could use a thicker piece of plywood. But that's the way you would use it for a larger drum. For a small drum, like a 6 or an 8 inch, I could mount the router and or the plate itself in a vise and just hold the router steady, and then I could take the drum and twist it to get my bearing edge. So this would be my setup for the inside edge. You don't have to overthink this. Just the board clamped to some, in this case, just some sawhorses clamped in place. As long as it's somewhat sturdy, that's fine. And this bearing will ride against that inside edge. Now, before I get to the router table, I want to use sandpaper here and I want to flatten this edge. So in other words, I want all the way around the drum, I want this edge to be in the same plane. Now, I have a single sheet of sandpaper here. It's not even held down. I can just use my hand. These are small drums. It's an 8-inch drum and a 6-inch drum. So I can do that with one piece of sandpaper. But if you have a bigger drum, you may need to use two pieces of sandpaper, one on one side, one on another. It's okay if you don't have sandpaper everywhere under the edge, but just tape it down here, and then, you know, you would split the difference and just turn this along that sandpaper using two different pieces. That's fine. This is a flat surface. It's a table saw, and I'm just going to take this and spin it, keep it flat. And already you can see I've pretty much flattened it out. There's a couple areas right here. Don't go crazy. Just as long as you can see clean wood everywhere, you're good to go. All right, there's a close-up for you. You see that exposed edge in that where I sanded through there? That's all you need to do. You don't have to go crazy. All right, that's the outside edge cut. Came out pretty good. And it is, just out of curiosity, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 layers on the outside exposed. There's more layers. Now I'm gonna have to cut the inside edge, and that's what really gives us this edge here. This cut fairly cleanly, but it definitely is gonna need some hand cleanup here because there is some fuzziness I wanna get rid of there. All right, so that's right off the router table what you see. Pretty good. I don't really have any complaints. You know, this is essentially plywood, so you're routing plywood, and you can expect some fuzziness and that kind of thing, which I will clean up with sandpaper by hand. And the as far as the bearing edge, though, it's nice and sharp here, so when I clean this up, it's going to be good. I think I probably will try to paint this. I'm not going to match this internal coating they did originally perfectly, But some paint will help, you know, consolidate all this. And after I paint it, let it dry, I may just do a very light sanding over the paint just to make it nice and smooth. As far as that bump area, let me find that. Yeah, so here's the bump area right here. And that's because of this, you know, this little seam right here. But again, not a big deal. Just this little section right here has to be done by hand. It's not even really that much. And I can easily accomplish that with sandpaper. All right, so that's it. I have some couple coats of paint on here. Now I may choose, this is still wet, but once it dries, I could do a really light sanding, or really more of a buffing than a sanding, just to get that dead smooth, and I might do one more coat of paint if I choose, but it's basically okay as it is. But I wanted you to see, I can't touch it because it's wet, but there's a nice sharp edge there now, and it really looks pretty good. So I think they're gonna sound a lot better than they did. Now they're still not perfectly in round, they're old drums, but you know, just having this clean bearing edge like this should make a big, big difference. So not really that hard to do. It really takes more time to set up the jigs and everything than it does to actually make the cuts.